I want to welcome you to another week where we can gather together for New City Church online. We're so glad that you're spending some time with us. We really pray that these messages in our series, Worst Day Ever, have been encouraging to you. Maybe they've been challenging to you, but really our desire is that they've been the push for you to find your hope in Jesus, to turn to Him when it seems like there's nowhere else to turn. He's been there the whole time. So yes, we have been in this series for 3 weeks now called Worst Day Ever, How to Handle Life's Toughest Moments. And I think we can all agree, yes, we've all had a really bad day, but we've all had a really challenging year together where some of those days when they stack up together, they can feel like the worst day ever. I mean, it doesn't really matter if it's just like an annoying day or if it really could be something serious, but we've all had bad days, and sometimes they can feel like the worst day ever. But how do we handle those? How do we handle it? And the idea that we want to keep driving home is that we need to believe that our bad days can be God's best moments. We need to believe that our bad days can be God's best moments. It's where He can turn things around. That's what this series has been about. We've been looking at this verse in Romans 8. It says, "We know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God." See, listen, God doesn't cause everything. I hope you understand that. See, God loves us enough to give us free will. And let's be honest, sometimes we put ourselves in worst day ever situations because of the choices that we've made. See, God doesn't cause everything, but here's what happens. God causes everything to work together for good. He doesn't cause everything, but He does cause everything to work together for good. Now, in our times together, we've talked about, you know, with the worst day ever, sometimes that involves bad news, and it's rarely as bad as we think it is. And so the challenge was, instead of believing all of the fears that are out there, let's not abandon our faith. These are the seasons where our faith is needed most. This is why we've built up our faith. So yes, bad days involve bad news, but let's replace those fears with our faith. And our last time together, we talked about the benefit that a really bad season can have. It kind of puts a magnifying glass on some of the relationships in our lives. Some relationships, unfortunately, they need to end, and a bad season will reveal that. Other relationships can spark something new in us. But really, the challenge was, when everyone is having a really bad season together, can we be a good friend? And can we spark something new in somebody else's life? Can we have sympathy and empathy for them and be quick to listen and slow to speak? And so today, I want to talk about what might be next in a worst day ever kind of situation. And really, it's not a phrase that I'm sure all of us really want to hear right now, but part of the worst day ever experience and how we handle that is to really give up control. We give up control. I mean, do you remember the first time that you realized that you weren't in total control of your life? Maybe 2020 has shown you that you're not in control of everything. And that's a tough moment to consider. That's a tough thing to live through. See, most of us tend to view life like we're in charge of a marionette kind of puppet. We think we have life by a string. We think maybe we've got a string that runs to our marriages and to our relationships, and we can control that. And then there's the string that runs to our finances, and we feel like we can control that too. And then, you know, if we're a dad or a mom or in a family, we've got a string that runs to our children, to our families, and all the things that are going on in their lives, we're feeling like we can manage that as well. What about our career and our success? And we've got all these strings pulled in all different kinds of directions, and we feel like we've got them under control, and we assume that we can make all of them do what we want them to do. We like control. And here's the bad thing about control is that we assume that if we work hard enough, or maybe if we pray long enough, that eventually we'll be able to manipulate the circumstances around us to our benefit. The trouble is, life doesn't always work that way. I want you to see something about control. The greatest illusion of all is the illusion of control. The greatest illusion of all is the illusion of control. In his book called Emotionally Healthy Spirituality, Peter Scazzaro says this: "I like control. I like to know where God is going, exactly what He is doing, the exact route of how we are getting there, and exactly when we will arrive. I also like to remind God of His need to behave in ways that fit with my clear ideas of Him. For example, God is just merciful, good, wise, and loving. The problem then is that God is beyond the grasp of every concept I have of Him. He is utterly incomprehensible. We like control. But the greatest illusion of all is the illusion of control. See, when we feel like our dreams are slipping away, when we feel like life is just getting out of control, we immediately do all that we can to grab control, to pull those strings tight and feel like we've got it under control. But what do you do on a worst day ever when you feel like your control is slipping away? Well, I want to go back to what we've been talking about with King David in the book of 2 Samuel. And we've already established that, you know, David is having one of the worst days ever. His son Absalom is making a play for his throne. He's threatening David's life. He's trying to take over the army, trying to insert himself as king, and he wants David out of there. And it's easy to go to Scripture and just see that moment and realize, oh man, that's a really bad day. I feel bad for David. But this has been building for a while, and I want to take you back a few chapters in 2 Samuel. Cover a lot of Scripture today, and you can find it starting in 2 Samuel chapter 13, and we'll go all the way to chapter 16. Don't worry, we're not going to read all of that. But I would encourage you to read that and really help you understand what we're talking about today. But David, this situation has been brewing for a while, and we see where David finally gets to the point in his worst day ever where he says, you know what, I thought I had control, but I don't. So David, as a young boy, had a dream that he would be king. Not a physical dream, but, you know, God sent a prophet to, pretty much dedicate him as king as a young boy. And so that dream began to grow. And now this dream is a reality in the book of 2 Samuel. He is king of Israel. But we'll see that dreams can be threatened. In those moments where we want to pull all the strings tighter in order to maintain control. See, what happens is David is king of Israel. The dream has come true. His children are all grown, but there's turmoil in his family. It is in this turmoil where we see David's control and his dream begin to slip away. See, in 2 Samuel chapter 13, we are introduced to some of David's children, Amnon, Tamar, and Absalom. We've talked about Absalom. See, David's firstborn son is Amnon. He will become the next king of Israel. Now, we've got to pause because this dream is getting bigger, because what the Bible tells us is that the family line of David will one day bring the Messiah, will bring Jesus into the world. So David is starting to realize, man, this is coming true. My offspring, my blood will be one day bringing in the Messiah that we've all longed for. This bigger dream, it hinges on the family line of David. So it seems everything is under control. David is king, and now he's got a son. But there's a problem. See, Amnon has fallen in love or lust with his half-sister Tamar. And he's willing to do everything he can in order to be with her and do what he wants with her. There's turmoil in David's family. See, Amnon manipulates his sister to come and be with him. And the Bible doesn't really beat around the bush. It tells us that he rapes her. And this is a huge problem in the family line of David and what God is trying to accomplish. I mean, that's the heir to the throne. See, after Amnon got what he wanted, he got the girl, he manipulated her, he took advantage of her, he decided that he was done with Tamar, and he banishes her from the palace. She's devastated. The family is devastated. There's turmoil in the house of David. And what happens next is so unbelievable. David makes this unwise choice as a parent, and he ignores all of it. He ignores what Amnon has done. He ignores what has happened to Tamar. He ignores what the family feels. He just hopes it will go away. He does nothing. Now listen, David might be a great man of God and a great king, a brilliant military man, but I would tell you, don't take parenting advice from King David. But not everyone ignored what happened to Tamar. David has another son, Absalom, who we know about. He chooses not to ignore this injustice, and he decides, I'm going to take matters into my own hands. If my father David won't take control of the situation, I will. Absalom will take control of the situation. So it says in Scripture that Absalom waited 2 years before he did anything. And what he does is he throws this big party. He invites all of his brothers, his sisters, his cousins, his parents, everybody of importance. And at this party, in front of everyone, Absalom murders his brother Amnon for what he did. He murders him in front of everybody. He purposely avenges his sister's rape by publicly murdering the man who was responsible. There's turmoil. Control is slipping away. And then you move into chapters 14 and 15, and we learn that Absalom, because of this, he becomes a fugitive. He's on the run. Absalom is a fugitive. David has a shattered daughter in Tamar. He has a murdered son named Amnon. And even though Absalom is on the run, he's a murderer. It says that David still loves him and longs to be with him. There's turmoil in David's family. See, Absalom eventually, it says he returns to Jerusalem, and that's where we kind of picked up in week one. He begins to serve as a judge and a governor outside the city walls. And over time, people begin to respect Absalom. People actually start to turn their hearts away from David and towards Absalom. The Bible would tell us Absalom becomes a leader that the people like. King David is distant. He's far off. He's too busy for the people to get him anymore. And Absalom is accessible. He's a man of action. He's a man of action in the face of injustice. Who wouldn't want to serve a leader like that? Absalom understands the people. Absalom listens to the people. In the minds of the people, Absalom is what David used to be to them. A very dangerous place, setting up the worst day ever. Absalom, who is still furious with Amnon and still furious with David's silence on the matter, he has another plan up his sleeve. We read about it in week one. With the hearts of the people on his side, he devises a scheme to overthrow King David and become the next king of Israel. You see that this control is slipping away, and it's slipping away over time. David thought he had it all under control, but he doesn't. Without even realizing it, David's control on his kingdom and on control of his family, control of his dream, it's beginning to slip away, and it's happening from somebody that's very dear to him. And here's the moment that we've talked about. It says in 2 Samuel 15, a messenger came and told David, the hearts of the men of Israel are with Absalom. See, David spent his whole life preparing to live out his dream, his calling to be the king of Israel. This is who he's become, and that's all he knows. But in one sentence, in one moment of bad news, his entire reality comes crashing down, and his control that he has over his family and his kingdom, it's slipping away. His own son has declared war on him and the nation of Israel. His dream is at risk. It's likely going to shatter. And the hardest part about all of this, listen, is that David felt like there was nothing he could do. Do you remember a moment like this? When you could no longer ignore the reality that what you had hoped for was not going to happen? Where you thought it was going to be a good day or a good season and it ended up being the worst ever? When there was nothing that you could do to change the outcome? Do you remember that? Maybe for you, you feel like the marriage is over and he's called the lawyer or she's called the lawyer. Maybe the school counselor has informed you that your kid is skipping classes, that their performance is down, and there's a real problem that they may not advance to the next grade. When your boss looks at you and he says, I'm sorry, but I have no other option, today's your last day. When the doctor says that there's nothing else they can do to help you, you can't ignore it anymore. What do we do when we feel like the control we once had is slipping away? Even though this is the worst day ever for David, it might be the worst day ever for you, we can learn something from how David responds to this. In 2 Samuel 15, verse 14, it says, then David said to all of his officials who were with him in Jerusalem, come, we must flee, or none of us will escape from Absalom. We must leave immediately, or he will move quickly to overtake us and bring ruin upon us and put the city to the sword. David realizes control is slipping away. And it might seem like he's running away, but he's not. Listen to what David says at the end of 2 Samuel chapter 15. It says, Zadok was there too, and all the Levites who were with him were carrying the Ark of the Covenant of God. They set down the ark of God, and Abiathar offered sacrifices until all the people had finished leaving the city. And listen to this. The king said to Zadok, take the ark of God back into the city. See, the ark of the covenant, the ark of God was supposed to be where the king was. And David realizes, I'm losing control. So he says, take the ark back into the city. He says, if I find favor in the Lord's eyes, he will bring me back. And he will let me see it in his dwelling place soon again. But if he says, I am not pleased with you, then I am ready. Let him do to me whatever seems good to him. What is David doing? David, listen, David is giving up control to God. He's giving up control to God. He says, God can do with me what he wants. I'm no longer going to try to hold all of these strings and manage it all. I have no longer have control, so I'm going to give control to God. Those words represent a monumental shift in David's life. He's no longer trying to run. He's no longer trying to manipulate. He's no longer trying to lie like he's done before. He's no longer trying to control every aspect of his life. He's not even truly giving up his throne, which is what it looks like. David is giving up control to God. He's recognizing that all this control that he had, that he thought he had, it was an illusion. And surrendering to God now is his only option. He finally recognizes the fact that God is God and he is not. What's it going to take for you and me to get to that same conclusion? That he is God and we aren't. That we don't have control. That the best thing that we can do is to give up control to God. What needs to happen? Maybe a worst day ever situation is exactly what God has us going through so that we will finally give up control to him. I want you to hear that. What's it going to take for us to give up control? Well, maybe it's a worst day ever kind of situation. Maybe that's exactly what God has us going through so that we will give up control to him. See, why does a worst day ever, why does that frustrate us so much? Because eventually, it's a reminder that control is an illusion. And we don't like to be reminded of that. We want to control the outcome of our lives. We want to win at all costs. We want to be right. We don't want to be surprised as to what happens to us. We want things done our way. We love this desire and this control. It's going to leak into every area of our life. And eventually, it leads to heartache and disappointment. See, not only are we tempted to think that we hold all the strings in our lives, we actually think we get to write the script. We think we're in charge of all of it. But letting go of control like David did can be a humbling and even a painful experience, but it's what needs to happen. And you'll see the conclusion of all of this in 2 Samuel chapter 16. Absalom moves into Jerusalem. He takes control of everything. He takes even the throne of David. But that wasn't enough for Absalom. Remember, he's acting on his revenge, on his anger. He wants justices to be served. He wanted more. Really, what Absalom wanted was more control. Absalom gathers all of the loyal followers and warriors, and he goes out with the intent to battle his own father, King David. Now listen, David is a great military mind, and he's got a lot of people who are still with him, who have left the city. David makes it very clear that he does not want to go to war with his son. But all of his advisors say, well, Absalom has forced your hand. And what happens is that David's army obliterates and crushes Absalom's army. And against David's very wishes and desires, Absalom ends up dying in the fight. So David retains his throne from this internal threat. He retains that throne while weeping over the death of another son. He retains his throne. He retains his dream. But he didn't do it by manipulation. He didn't do it by running or lying. He didn't even do it by trying to maintain control. David retains his throne by surrendering control to God. In essence, this part of David's life could be marked by these simple words. It's as if David is saying, Lord, it's not my dream. It's not even my picture of the way that life should be. but it's your dream, God. Can you and I say the same thing? It's not my dream. It's not my picture of the way that life should be, but it's your dream, God. That's giving up control. But I know what some of you are thinking. You don't like giving up. You don't like tapping out. You don't like waving the white flag. We like to maintain control even if it destroys us. But listen to me, giving up control is not the same as giving up. Giving up control is not the same as giving up. When it comes to our worst day ever kind of situations, the best course of action is to actually give up control to God. Now, the world around you, your family, your friends, those who love you, they may think that you are giving up. They might even tell you that you're giving up. But you're actually giving up control to God. See, just because our will won't be done doesn't mean that God's will won't be done. See, we can't try to control and maintain what we actually can't control and maintain. You see, just because our will won't be done doesn't mean that God's will won't be done. This may not be the story that you are planning to write, but we aren't God. We can abandon our dream and what we expected it to look like, but don't you dare abandon God. You give up control to Him. Now, I know giving up to control to God, it gives us a lot of options. See, when life doesn't turn out the way that we thought it would, when we experience this worst day ever kind of scenario, we may think that we're losing control. We may feel like we're giving up and that the world would accuse us of giving up on our dreams. But the truth is, remember, you never had control in the first place. The only thing we control is how we respond to disappointment, to unexpected obstacles. We control how we respond to the worst day ever. So what will you do? Here are some options, and you may be doing some of these already, and I would encourage you to really take an introspective look at your heart. You know what you could do? You could allow fear and disappointment and anger to control you. But this idea that I've got to be in control, that unless I'm not, I'm going to live in fear and rage and disappointment. See, that rage is going to affect every relationship that you touch, every job, every dream. See, if you pick that anger and that rage, that you pick it up in college, it's going to leak into your marriage. And then it will leak into your career. It's going to leak into your parenting, and it's just going to keep going and going and going. You could live that way. And you could let all of that fear and disappointment and anger control you. We can live the rest of our lives being bitter because something didn't work out the way that we thought it should. We can choose to never work through the pain. We can choose to never work through the fear, never work through the disappointment, never work through the rage. We can continue to inflict all of this emotional turmoil on ourselves and let it leak into every relationship we have. We can let fear and disappointment and anger control us. Hopefully you're not there, but I think a lot of us do the second thing. What we do is we just keep trying harder. We keep trying harder. We turn ourselves inside out trying to make things happen, to hold on to all of these strings no matter what it takes. We keep throwing ourselves at our problems. We wear ourselves out trying to maintain all of these puppet strings. The truth is we can pull and we can tug and we can pull those strings and we can still have our dreams and our plans and our expectations dissolve right in front of our eyes. So we can do that. But my prayer is that we would give up control to God. That we could take these strings and we could actually hand them to somebody who knows what they're doing. God, take my finances. You know what you're doing. Let me do things your way. God, take my parenting. Help me. God, take my career. Take my relationships. Take my marriage. Take my worst day ever kinds of things. God, you can handle it much better. Because of this, we'll have a better shot at surviving a worst day ever. When we do this, here's what happens. We give God permission to do His best work in the midst of our greatest letdowns, in the midst of our greatest disappointments, our mistakes, and our shattered dreams. Listen to me. If you don't hear anything else, please hear this. When giving up control is not the same as giving up. Don't you dare believe that. Giving up control is not the same as giving up. When it comes to our worst day ever, The best course of action is to actually give up control to God. Give him the strings. Let him do what he wants to do. Because the world and your family and your friends and those you love, they will come against you and they may even say that you're just giving up. But you're giving control to God. Because just because our will won't be done doesn't mean that God's will won't be done. We can try to control. We can try to maintain what we can't control and what we can't maintain. Listen, it might not be the story that you thought. But we aren't God. We can give up control to God. I don't know what worst day ever situation you might be going through. But I do know this. You can let go of all of the control and let God do what he wants to do. It's not easy. It's not easy, but it's the best decision that you could ever make. And so I want to invite some of you who may be watching our broadcast today. Giving up control to God, it seems like this far-fetched idea because maybe you don't even believe in God or you're not sure where you stand in relationship with God, that you feel like maybe God's angry with you because you haven't been following him. We don't think it's a mistake that you're watching this broadcast today. We want to help you through life's tough moments, and one of the ways to do that is to give up control to God, but you've got to give your faith to him. You've got to stop trying to just try to be in control of everything. Because there's a God in heaven who knows your name and he wants to help you and he wants you to get through the worst day ever with his help. And so I want to invite those who may be watching, maybe for the first time, you acknowledge, you know what, I haven't been following God. And listen, you might not get all the answers to all your questions. I know there's a lot of questions about Christianity and about God and about Jesus. And we want to get you plugged into a church. We want to get you plugged into New City Church and help you work out those questions. But today, there's a decision you need to make that will help you for the rest of your life. Not only will you give up control to God, but will you give your heart to God? Will you give your faith to him? Will you give your trust to him? Because listen, if you put it into people, they're going to let you down. If you put it into money, it's going to let you down. If you put it into your status, it's going to let you down. But you can put your hope and your trust and your faith in God, and he will never let you down. So if that's you and you want to make a decision to follow Jesus today, I just want you to do something with me. I want you to say this next prayer with me and believe in your heart that things are going to turn around. That you may not be able to get over the worst day ever right now, but at least you're going to have God with you. And the first step is to put your faith in him. So would you bow your head and close your eyes with me wherever you are? You could be watching in your car, watching at home, watching with your family. But if that's a decision that you want to make, you can do that today as we're gathering together for online. So let's pray together. Dear Jesus, I acknowledge that I've made some mistakes. And I admit that I have not put my trust in you. That I've been trying to do things on my own. Maybe I feel like I'm far away from you or that you're angry with me. But today I believe that you are the Son of God. And that your love for me is unfathomable. It's unexplainable. It's too big for me to even grasp. But God, I believe today that you are the Son of God and that you died for my sins and that you rose from the dead so I could have eternal life. And I confess, Lord, that I've done some wrong things, but I want to live my life for you for the rest of my life. Not only do I want to give up control to you, but I want to give my life to you. Help me from now on to know that I'll still experience what feels like the worst day ever, but now you are with me. And I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. Listen, if you prayed that prayer, the Bible tells us all of heaven is celebrating and we're celebrating with you. We would love to connect you with you and get to know you and get you a Bible and get you plugged into what our church is doing. But we have been praying for you. And listen, this is for everybody. Listen, let's grab those strings that we're trying to hold on to. And let's give control to God, because giving up control is not the same as giving up. And listen, we pray that these messages are a help to you. We pray that we can encourage you and that you can get through life's toughest moments because God is with you, because you have people who love you and who are with you, and because you can do the most freeing thing. You can give up control to God, and he'll do what only he can do. Listen, if you want to get more information about our church, you can visit our website at newcityde.org. We've got a lot of information on there. And if you're comfortable and ready, we would love to see you as we worship together in person at New City Church. We have live worship services every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. We're following all the CDC guidelines, asking everyone to wear a mask and practice social distancing. We even have safe environments for your kids and for your teenagers that we have reopened recently. And we're just believing that God is going to just meet us in those moments, that His Holy Spirit will be with us, and we would love to meet you. If you prayed that prayer today, would you do me a favor? At the end of this broadcast today, there's a way for you to connect with me or to connect with my wife, and we'd love to pray with you, to get to know you. We'd love to get you a Bible, and we'd love to meet you and pray with you. But listen, everybody, we can get through the worst day ever. We can handle life's toughest moments, and sometimes it just takes us giving our control to God. God bless you. Thank you for joining us, and have a great day.